Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming out here. It's very nice. And I want to thank Saul Williams for personally coming out here and kicking your ass. Because you look like you got your asses kicked by Saul Williams. We'll be right back. Recently named Jeremy Ward, I'd like to dedicate the rest of my life's work to that gentleman because he's a very beautiful human being. And I don't think that one day goes by that we don't miss that motherfucker. So this song is for Jeremy. We'd love to see all of you here. We'd be really stoked on this.
House has the way.
my sister out there, Jennifer.
We'll be right back. Hey, what's going on, Austin? I'm Dave. This is Raw Time. Welcome to it. We're out here. I've been here many times at Emo's little beer garden area. I want to thank all the folks at Emo's for always letting us do this thing. And I want to say big thanks to Jeff and Kristen for hooking us up with Omar from Mars Volta, man. The Mars Volta. I knew I would do that. Doesn't that suck?
That's fine.
All right, cool. Omar, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good.
Thanks for taking time to sit with us out here and tell us and the world, all my viewers, all about the Mars Volta, man. They're on tour. They've been on tour for quite a while. I don't know where to start. The first time that everyone told me about the Mars Volta was after y'all came through with the Snoop Dogg and the Chili Peppers show, and that was in close to San Antonio down here. And everyone I work with was just like, "Holy shit, man! The Mars Volta is like amazing show." And you know, can't wait for the CD and get it all that shit. So it was really cool. And now this is like the headline show at Emo's. From Texas anyway.
Yeah.
How's that feel coming back and doing all these sold-out Texas dates?
I guess it's nice. We try not to pay too much attention to all the external things about sold-out or reviews or anything like that, because we don't want it to block any of the energy that's coming in for us internally. So, but it does obviously feel nice.
It's got to be great. I know, you know, myself, that I would think that maybe it just kind of your expectations might get, you know, affected by knowing that things were huge, you know, so it's got to be a tough line to walk, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, this first record, really, you know, for the world, and we got the first video and the whole thing, so it's to be accepted, at least with the people that I know, in the way that it is, I can see this band going really far, and it's a great sound. I mean, a lot of influences kind of come to mind of some pretty cool old school stuff, but the sounds they're making are, if you've heard the CD, you know it's kind of hard to describe. It's a new kind of a sound that's coming together with everything in one bunch. It's a bunch of combinations of things, I thought. Is that collectively from the members in the band being influenced by different things?
Definitely. I think it's a matter of us understanding that influence is not limited to music. A lot of people that play music or write literature or paint paintings are kind of limited by the idea that their influence is synonymous with their medium. And for us, it isn't that way. Like a big influence in this band, probably larger than music itself, is film. The works of Luis Buñuel, or Werner Herzog, or Alejandro Jodorowsky. And so, so when you have these outside influences that have nothing to do with music, it creates something interesting to get the transference of energy from a medium that you really love, and trying to find a way to, you know, to make it speak in music. You know, it's not as easy as saying, you know, I like this band, how do I make that sound? And then you find a certain note or a certain chord that has a similar feeling. It's much different to watch a scene in a movie that you really love and to kind of chase after that feeling. So.
And it's much more meaningful, I'm sure, to walk away having felt that you've communicated something in that way. You know, I mean,
definitely. It's the labor. You know, anything that you put a lot of time and energy into is always going to, you know, turn out way better than fast food.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. There's so many things I want to get to. I do want to just go ahead, if you can talk. It's kind of a concept album, and maybe you could let us know in your words what this album is all about, and you know, people think about while they're hearing this.
Well, it's what people have to understand is that it's inspired by our friend Julio Venegas, who took his own life in '96, but the album is not necessarily about him. He's the inspiration for the character Cerpin Taxt, and all the discoveries that he has along the way in his subconscious, because the record takes place in his subconscious.
Mm-hmm.
And the character goes into a coma, and he has battles with, you know, the quote unquote good, quote unquote bad parts of his subconscious, trying to convince him to live, and the others convince him to die. And in the end, he wakes up and he takes his own life. But it's really just, you know, a work of science fiction and grandiose, you know, just fairy tale type storytelling, which is the way that Cedric likes to work, and Jeremy, who also helped write the story, likes to work also. So, yeah.
That's great. That's amazing. It's actually kind of a continuation of something I believe you touched on with At the Drive-In.
Yeah, we had one song called Imbroglio with our first At the Drive-In record, and that one was a little. That one was a little closer to the truth.
Yeah.
That one was more, you know, it happened right when we were doing pre-production for that record, and we were quite literally practicing that song before it had a face when we found the news. And so that one's a more black and white, you know, is that I had a friend who died for something he really loved and this and that. And this record is more of our gift to him. It's our going away present. It's a way, you know, and in the end, it's the only review of the record that matters is his. And to how many years that we can find out that review, I don't know. But
it's cool, man. It's got to be, you know, good for you to know that you've done it. And in your mind, you've done something that helps you deal with all of that, I assume.
Definitely.
You just got back from Puerto Rico, I guess?
Yeah.
Puerto Rico, and you're doing a lot of touring and stuff. How's that, man? I mean, you know, going everywhere.
It's great. It's what playing in a band is really all about. It's about the exchange of influence and the exchange of culture and ideas, you know?
Yeah.
Things can become so sterile if you're just sitting in one place and trying to become some kind of hometown hero or some kind of...
Austin, Texas, dude. Yeah. That's what it's all about here.
Yeah, a lot of people stay in one place and like kind of like they get championed somewhere and they're afraid to challenge themselves and play in front of two people because they've gotten used to playing in front of 500 or 1,000 or whatever. And for us, we constantly need these challenges to you know, reaffirm ourselves of our existence and of our ideology. So, you know, for example, we're playing the Latino Music Awards, you know, and aside from being predominantly a Latino band, we really have nothing in common with this type of activity, this type of, you know, illusion of there being the best of something or a winner or a loser.
That's gonna be weird, yeah.
It's definitely weird, but again, it feels great to go and play in front of these people who, for the most part, will have no idea what we're about and what we're doing. And, you know, there's Ricky Martin and then there's us, you know. The idea of this to us is really great, just like touring with the Chili Peppers. I mean, they're great friends of ours, but in reality, you know, we're talking about on an average 9 to 10,000 people who have no idea what we're about, could care less, and just want to see them play.
Mm-hmm.
And this type of challenge really brings out all kinds of things that, you know, it's just a different temperature than playing to a room of 500 people that really love your music and are singing along and are happy that you're there.
Yeah, I think the most important things about the two types of scenarios you just described were the walls that you're breaking down. You know, you're throwing those walls down with your music, man, and people that, as you said, would never hear it or had a clue who you were, they got to look at it. Because they're waiting for Ricky Martin.
Or they're waiting
for Flea's cock to swing around in a sock. Do they still do that?
No, not at all.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Not at all.
So Flea and Dave actually played on the record. Is that
John.
Oh, was it John? I thought Dave did some. Did you do something with Dave?
No. John.
Yeah. Frusciante. John Frusciante did it. Cool. Well, I love John Frusciante's solo work a lot.
I just played on his record too, on his new solo.
Oh, did you really? Oh, man.
Yeah,
that's so cool. Absolutely. It's definitely a pleasure meeting you. This is pretty much the bulk of the serious stuff. I had a few other things that I just wanted to ask. I have a lot of people on the internet, fans of the band, that we chat a lot about stuff, whether it be message board or rooms or whatnot. They want to know if there is an official audience taping policy with the band.
Yeah, the official audience taping policy would be tape away.
Video,
audio, do what you want, bootleg what you... We're not trying to keep our music in some sort of prison, or start trying to say that you have to pay for it to hear it. Quite to the contrary, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, there was many times in my life when I couldn't afford to see a concert, and if I could hear it on video or hear it on the tape, if I could record on cassette from a record of a friend of mine, that's, you know, eventually when I had the money, I would go buy the record because I need the artwork.
Absolutely,
I need the lyrics,
man.
And I need to smell the smell of the paper and where it was printed and what the liner notes say and what other bands they talk about. And there's always going to be people like us that need that.
And the buzz, though, that you get from something so special as a live recording or a demo or something a friend passed along to a friend that turns you on to a band is amazing. I mean, I can name, you know, I mean bands like Metallica or whatever that I've been turned on to that way, you know? I mean, it could go anywhere. So
it's the way it should be. If it captures your interest, you're gonna search after it, but you need the something that will take you to the water.
Yeah.
You know, you know, when you go to Cedric says when you go to Baskin Robbins, they let you taste the ice cream before you buy something. So.
Hell yeah, that's cool, man. What do you guys do when you're on the road from town? I guess is this like your first state right now though, right? I just like, what are you doing? You know, between town to town, are you watching films like you say, or
for the
music,
most part?
Or?
Yeah, for the most part. I mean, we lay low. I mean, most of us like to go back to the hotel and just watch, you know, watch a movie on TV or go out and see a film. Or I always travel with my 8-track and some equipment, so I'm constantly writing and recording you know, our new material on the road. So,
cool.
You know, and we like to go to a lot of different bookstores, and we're food connoisseurs.
Oh, so. Cool. Yeah, this could be in Austin. You should spend some time here in Austin, my friend. Austin is the place for that, for sure. Sure, you know all about the Austin being in the Texas. But, you know, that's really all I got. I want to thank you again for your time and wish you best of luck on this leg of the tour. And I know next time that these guys come to town, I'll be like, yeah, I remember when I used to get interview them. You're huge, dude. You're going to sell tons of records. But I know you all be the same people, and I wish you the best of luck.
So, thank you.
Have a great show tonight. This is Raw Time, and he's got to go hang with the old former Midnight from Master Control man, Matt. And you give him hell, man. Austin right. Music Network's got these guys next. This is Raw Time on Austin's original music channel, Channel 10, and we will see you.
You might be screaming, no, no, no. All they hear is, who wants cake?
Hey, you're watching Dave TV. I love you so much.
You'll die now!
Feel the power.
Hard rocking Texas boys. Over the years.
Can you believe that we are like each other? Part of something that we can't yet discover.
Nah, I'm just kidding. Fuck you.
You might be screaming, no, no, no. All they hear is, who wants cake?